Happy.
And you joined us in Fairbanks, Alaska, on a typically beautiful Alaskan weekday. So I'm pleased to be able to welcome you to Washington, D.C., where once again our weather is quite spectacular. So welcome to spring in Washington, D.C. It is good to be with the parliamentarians of the Arctic region again. I believe that we appreciate that interest in the Arctic, both by the general public, by the media, the Arctic nations, and the non-Arctic nations, that this interest continues to grow. And the attention is primarily due to the impacts of climate change, subsequent loss of seasonal sea ice, the interest in shipping and natural resources, certainly all of the attention that polar bears and their changing habitat has received. This has captivated many, many in the United States and around the globe. Until recently, the resources of the Arctic were deemed to be too difficult and too expensive to develop. But with increasing access and high energy and mineral prices, the Arctic's wealth is now being intensely discovered, explored, and developed. And this makes energy exploration certainly very important and a very serious issue for Arctic policy as we move forward. This includes the conventional oil and gas, but also methane hydrates and other less conventional energy forms as well. Offshore in my state of Alaska, we are estimating perhaps 15 billion barrels of oil in a concentrated area of the Chukchi Sea, and 8 billion barrels in the Beaufort Sea. And we're hopeful that these exploratory wells will prove up this summer. The United States Geological Survey tells us that the region has up to 30% of the world's undiscovered gas and 13% of its oil. We also think that it holds huge amounts of other mineral resources, such as coal, nickel, copper, tungsten, lead, zinc, gold, silver, diamonds, manganese, chromium, and titanium. But I think that there's a natural and perhaps even a reflexive tendency to question how in the world it can ever be safe or even economical to drill and to produce in such a harsh, misunderstood, and distant environment. But it is happening, and the technology and the engineering behind some of the existing and proposed activities really is quite fascinating. We already know that Russia is turning its eye to the Arctic's vast energy reserves. They're building the first offshore oil rig that can withstand temperatures as low as minus 50 degrees Celsius and also withstand the pressures from the heavy pack ice. As their oil production is in decline, they are also reducing taxes and bureaucratic hurdles in order to encourage new oil development within the Arctic. They're also planning for a near wholesale replacement of their icebreaker fleet in order to better operate in the polar region. By the same token, there's an energy company from England who is now readying to seriously explore for oil and natural gas for the first time off the coast of Greenland. This kind of activity in the Arctic, combined with the declining summer sea ice, has positive implications for energy security across borders because LNG and oil tankers will in some cases be able to have alternatives to their current more dangerous and truly clogged routes through the Southeast Asian Straits and the Gulf of Aden and, of course, the Suez Canal. So non-Arctic nations are going to see benefit in this way, but they can also benefit from the funding element of these huge projects. The exploration, the production, and certainly the construction necessary to develop Arctic resources is going to require all different types of financing, not just for the sheer scale
and remoteness of the projects, but for the level of technology needed to bring them online in a way that's safe for workers, safe for the environment, and as insulated from risk as possible. I had an opportunity not too many months back to go to New Orleans and visit a 4D seismic room where the images that are acquired through 3D are basically animated to give a sense of the shifting oil and the gas reservoirs so that geologists can study the trends and get a much more telling picture of the resource potential. It's almost surgical compared to the basic exploratory drilling which has occurred traditionally, certainly in the last century. It gives me a level of confidence that wells can be targeted and explored without unnecessary impacts to surrounding areas. And I think this is just one example of ways in which the technology is able to provide some level of reassurance about whether the world is indeed ready for increased energy development in the Arctic. We have a project in Alaska. It's called the Liberty Project. And some of you may be familiar with it. It's extended reach drilling. Parker Drilling has helped develop for the BP field to access an oil field directionally. The oil field is about 8 miles away from the Liberty pad itself. It's not quite there yet, but I'm hoping and I'm betting on good news from Alaska's North Slope that we can reach both literally and figuratively in these directions to provide access to the resource. And this brings me to another point. Technology is advancing because oil and natural gas are still the most economically valuable energy sources in the world. The term easy oil is now being slowly redefined as these technologies develop, and I've have to predict that we will see a measured but certain expansion into Arctic lands and waters. And this is significant because the first peoples of the Arctic, the indigenous peoples, have a right to benefit by all of their resources, not just the energy, but certainly their fisheries, their marine mammals on which they depend for their nutrition and their livelihoods. And I'm encouraged by what I'm seeing as an increasing level of engagement rather than opposition from these constituencies. 30 years ago, when we were just beginning to develop our oil resources on America's largest oil field, Prudhoe Bay in Alaska, we truly involved our native peoples in almost every aspect of this new and really massive change to their land and to their lifestyle. And there was engagement. It was sometimes contentious. It was oftentimes very, very difficult. There was engagement on the legislative level, on the administrative level, on the operational level, and on the personal level. And the ultimate result has benefited all Alaskans and our national energy security in ways beyond which we could have imagined at that time. Now, it's not just Arctic energy that is drawing increased activity into the region. The impacts of an ice-diminished Arctic are already affecting marine shipping. We recently saw two German vessels complete a commercial transit from Asia to Europe through the Arctic Ocean north of Russia. The two multipurpose heavy lift carriers transited through the Northeast Passage or the Northern Sea Route during August and September of last year. The route is now open for a short time in late summer. It cuts about 4,000 nautical miles from the 11,000 mile long traditional route going through the Suez Canal and the Gulf of Aden. We now have reports that a Russian shipping firm has announced that it will use one of its ice-strengthened Arctic tankers to carry oil from the Kara Sea across the Northern Sea Route to Japan this year. This would be a proof of concept that could also apply to LNG tankers based on the same dual-acting icebreaker tanker design used for oil tankers. And while the Arctic Marine Shipping Assessment predicts that it will be decades before these routes are open for many months of the year, I think we must consider that this is only the beginning. If it proves to be economical, it will happen. I believe that we're making progress here in the United States in raising the awareness and the importance of the Arctic. I know in some of our meetings in the past, questions have been asked of me as the U.S. representative, does the United States acknowledge its role as an Arctic nation? I do believe that that awareness is coming about. You'll get an update on the Arctic regional policy that was released by the previous administration in early 2009. Ambassador David Bolton of the State Department will report on that. I do believe that we are at a very critical time in the Arctic right now. There seems to be two paths that we can go down in regards to international relations. One is a path of competition and conflict, and the other is a path of cooperation and diplomacy. And I believe the decision on which path we ultimately take will require dynamic leadership. And while some have described a scenario where the Arctic is undergoing an arms race or a race for resources, I'm not absolutely convinced that this is the case. We know that there are national security and sovereign interests for all the Arctic coastal states in the region. The United States Navy has a new roadmap for the Arctic. I have asked them to study the feasibility of a deep water port in the far north. So we introduced legislation to direct this study. The study will determine whether it's in the strategic best interests of the United States, as I believe it is, to build a port and where that port should be located. A deep water port would not only serve our military and Coast Guard needs, but as we develop our offshore oil and gas reserves and see more shipping, more tourism, and vessel traffic in the Arctic, a deep water port could provide valuable support for these activities as well. The Coast Guard has also embarked on a high latitude study to determine what assets and what infrastructure they need to be prepared for an ice-diminished Arctic Ocean. And with increased maritime activity in the Arctic and such a shortage of infrastructure, it's vital that we determine what the needs are and actively work to provide the resources to protect the Arctic residents and the environment. The Arctic clearly offers an opportunity to work collaboratively and cooperatively. Secretary of State Hillary Clinton has confirmed that the Arctic is one area in which the Obama administration will highlight international cooperation in the implementation of U.S. foreign policy. This follows the administration's intent to reset relations with Russia, and the Arctic is really the perfect place to start that process. I am also encouraged that discussions for a multilateral Arctic-wide search and rescue plan is underway. This is certainly one area that I think we could agree that Arctic nations can agree on and work together to implement. So really, what does the future hold for the Arctic? Is it going to be an area of multinational cooperation or an area of conflict? Clearly, the Arctic region presents daunting challenges and unique opportunities relating to climate change, resource development, and geopolitical transformation. I am hopeful, I am very hopeful, that the future will be one of cooperation. We know that the Arctic holds vast energy reserves, tremendous potential, and we've got an interest to share our best practices and to work together to develop a regime that will lead us to safe and secure activities with the maximum level of environmental protection, all of which I believe is very, very possible. Again, I appreciate the opportunity to speak before you on this issue today. Happy to answer any questions that you may have, but am delighted to be able to welcome you to today's meetings and the opportunities that we will have later in the afternoon to visit and discuss these issues of importance. So thank you, Mr. Chairman.